These are some pretty interesting headphones. These are the Audacy LCDX. These were sent in to me by a friend. Thank you very much, Koji. And for every reason I have to love these and why other people might love them, I have another reason as to why some people are going to hate these. I've got pretty mixed thoughts. If you want a super short 30-second version of this review, these are going to be fantastic for people who listen to stuff like electronic music, where low end and speed is really important, timbre not really a concern. For anyone who listens to acoustic or anything vocal related, these aren't going to work. That's the short version. Let's talk about the build, because these are an Audacy headphone, and Audacy headphones, quite rightly, have a reputation for being very heavy. The build on these is super substantial. This feels incredibly solid. Nothing is going to damage these unless you really show them some abuse. But these are so heavy. Oh my god, they're heavy. It's not my neck that hurts when wearing them, though. It's my cheeks, because this headband does almost nothing in the way of helping to distribute the weight over the top of your head. Everything, as you can see here, is just pressing in against the side of your head. These pads are pretty plush on the back, and then the front is really quite firm. So that, after an hour or so of listening, does get a little bit intense. I don't like listening to these for long periods of time because the comfort does start getting to me. These aren't an uncomfortable headphone. There are definitely a lot of headphones where you put them on and you go, oh wow, this is unpleasant. This isn't one of them. But going from this to an Aria, it feels like I'm wearing nothing at all. So the build of the headphones itself is good, but also bad because it's not light at all. The pads, let's say another thing about those, they're glued. You can't remove these. These are not clipped on. They are glued on, which for a headphone costing this much is, in my opinion, unacceptable. That shouldn't happen. There's no reason that should happen. I don't particularly like Hi-Fi Man's clip system, but having a clip system of some sort is a hell of a lot better than having them glued to the headphone. Okay, cable. This is a Heart Audio cable, which Koji also sent me. That was both because this is balanced so that I can try them on my AHP2, and also because the stock cable is not good. This is a stiff, thick kind of piece of rubber. But if I hold it like that, yeah, you can see there's a crease. It holds itself up. It tangles super easily. It feels pretty awful. I do not like, this cable's bad. I do like, though, that it's using mini XLR. There's a lot of headphones nowadays which are using some proprietary connector like the HD800 or something which, even if it's not proprietary, is expensive or hard to get hold of, like the Utopia and their Limo connectors. If all headphones would just use mini XLR or 3.5mm like Hi-Fi Man uses, life would be a lot better. So the fact that these are using just mini XLR, that's fantastic, because it makes getting a custom or replacement cable a hell of a lot easier. So, the main reason you're going to buy these is low-end. The low-end on these is really, really fast. It's fast, it's punchy, it's slammy. It's a lot closer to dynamic driver-type bass than most planars are. And you can run these on anything. A lot of planars, like the Aria, those need a lot of amplification in order to sound their best. These will get perfectly loud enough on even a JDS Atom, an L30 or something like that, but the low end does not sound right. It's not as punchy or weighty as impactful as it should be. If you put these on an Asgard 3 or an AHB2 or an A90 or something like that, it's a lot different. This, you can literally run it on a dongle. You can run these on nothing but willpower, pretty much. You don't need much power at all to run these. I'm using the Benchmark AHB2 just because it's the amp that I use to compare all headphones. I mean, the noise floor on this, even though it's a speaker amp, is so low you can literally run IEMs on it. And so obviously that drives these fine. You don't need much power. Low end is the main reason to buy these, because the low end is super fast. It's pretty weighty. Let's continue with the song that I was using in the intro, which is The Light by DLMT. This doesn't feel soft at all. It's snappy, it's fast. Let's quickly try something which is really quite snappy. See ya. This is good because it's got a kind of synth snare going on at the same time as the low-end punch, and it feels fantastic. It feels and sounds fantastic on these headphones. And that's kind of a good word, because although I dislike the fact that these are really heavy and weighty on your head, interestingly enough, the combination of that with the Arias, you can sometimes just forget that you're wearing headphones. And that, combined with their big soundstage and layering performance, makes them sound very open. I think comfort and the fit of a headphone actually influences how you hear it more than most people think. And this, the weight of it, the force of it, combined with the speed and impact of the low end, makes it really good fun. It doesn't feel like it's trying to sound open and airy and natural. It feels like it's trying to just make you want to dance. It's trying to make you rock. It's really, really good fun. Low-end sub-bass is good. Low-end timbre is okay. But the speed and snappiness of it and the immediacy is really, really nice, especially for a planar. There are not many other planars that will be as snappy as this is, other than if you put them on a really, really powerful amp. Treble then. Treble is an interesting one on these. I actually quite like it. It extends really far, and it gives quite an airy presentation. It's airy. Let's pick something like Imagination. This has got quite a lot of stuff going on in a distance. It sounds pretty wide. It's not the biggest soundstaging headphone, but it's certainly not small either. It does not at all feel closed in. The main issue I have with staging is that it could definitely use more frontal depth. Stuff gets pretty wide. You can hear the reverb going off to the left and the right, but then actual frontal depth back and forth and stuff behind you, there's not much to it. A lot of vocals will sound very much in your head because of that, so that's something which not many people will particularly want, but it might not be too distracting for a few either. In terms of the actual treble and its evenness, this is a bit of a tricky one. There is a lot of unit variation on these headphones. You can buy one of these and it'll sound different to another pair. This isn't something which it's just hearsay, oh, does it, doesn't it? People have bought multiple pairs and measured them. They sound different. They have different responses in the treble. So there's a bit of a lottery there. This particular pair sounds really good. I actually like the treble on this quite a lot. It's smooth. It's not fatiguing. It's not sibilant. It's clean and extends well. I really don't have any qualms with it at all, but it's important to note that not everyone is going to have the same experience just because of the unit variation. Let's try something else real quick. So if we go for Never Count on Me, you've got these little bells going off, and it all sounds good. It doesn't at all feel like anything is being hidden, anything's being veiled. The resolution is, I don't want to say it's amazing. It's not as resolving as an Aria, it's not as resolving as an HD800, but it certainly doesn't feel like you're lacking anything. And more to the point, this isn't a headphone which is going for outright resolution. As I said, the main reason you buy these is for the low end. The main reason you buy these is because you love electronic music, EDM, and you want something that makes you feel the music, not that's showing you every last little detail. These aren't going to work for orchestral stuff. These aren't going to work for acoustic stuff. The shape of the soundstage is a little bit boxy at times, which makes acoustic recordings sound slightly off. And the resolution is good. It's not amazing for the price, but it's certainly not lacking. Where things really start to fall apart, though, is the lower treble, upper mids. And by fall apart, I mean it's not there. It's just non-existent. On the screen at the moment, you can see the frequency response for these headphones. And as you can see, there is just an absolute chasm of nothingness. Now, that has the biggest impact on vocals. Vocals are the one thing which really do not sound right on this headphone. Let's pop this on and play something with male vocals. Let's do Andrew Bird, capsized. Let's give him a DAC a sec to lock. Because of that complete lack of the upper mids, it sounds like everyone's kind of singing like this. It sounds like everyone's singing with their nose clogged. All the vocals sound really very nasally and thin. And that's very distracting. This track should have a lot more body to the vocals. It should sound quite different. And coming from almost any other headphone, even an HD800, which the upper mid dip on that is a problem to some, coming from that to this, it's a different level. There's just not enough presence there. Before I started this review, I asked in my Telegram chat, which, by the way, if you support me on Patreon or Subscribestar, we have a private Telegram chat, which I think you'll enjoy. We just talk about audio stuff all day, and I get feedback and share upcoming ideas and stuff like that. I asked about whether or not I should review these with EQ, and now normally I would never review a headphone with EQ. As soon as you start introducing EQ, there are an infinite number of ways the headphone can sound, and at that point it also becomes very, very subjective in how you tune it. The difference here is that if a manufacturer says, hey, you should run these headphones on a 6-watt per channel amplifier, and you run them on a 1-watt amp and they sound bad, that's not the headphone's fault. That's your fault, because you're not using them as the manufacturer stated. Audizy has an EQ for these. They have an EQ for many of their headphones, and you can access this by downloading the Audizy Reveal software, which there's a link to in the description, or if you're using Rune like I am, you can actually access it in here too. So you literally just go Add Filter, Audizy Presets. I've got one here, which is just LCDX Reveal, and you just select your headphone. What this is doing is applying this EQ curve. Now, it's just a slight bass boost, a big dip, or rise rather, in the upper mids, and then something at 10K as well. Don't quite know why it's changing that. But the biggest thing is it's trying to fix that upper mid chasm, and it makes these sound a lot better. So I was a little bit torn on whether I should evaluate these headphones with or without the EQ, because on one hand, I want to evaluate a product as it comes stock. I don't want to tune it myself. And secondly, on the other hand, I was thinking, well, maybe that's how the manufacturer is intending for me to use them. Is it fair to judge them if I'm not doing what the manufacturer says? And in the end, we decided to review it both ways. That was the best way to do it. And so I've expressed my concern about the upper mid chasm. Vocals do not sound right on this headphone, and it really does present a problem for a lot of music. Electronic stuff, things where you don't actually have a reference for timbre, it's not a problem because you're just looking at low-end speed, detail, impact, and things like that there. You're not looking for something to sound right in that vocal range or timbrally accurate. But for acoustic music like this, which is capsized by Andrew Bird, it makes a big difference. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to play a different song. I'm going to play Imagination by Foster the People because his voice is quite high. And so I'm going to turn the EQ on halfway through playback. Let's just quickly turn it off again. Off we go. And play this. We can't control. It's summer, somewhere, so you should. Suddenly the vocals get a lot more full. Suddenly things don't sound anywhere near as incorrect. It does not fix the problem. The issue is still there, and if you are wanting something which is great for vocals, these headphones aren't going to be amazing in any situation. But this really does help. It does transform the headphones quite significantly. And if you have these or are planning on getting them, I would 100% use the EQ. So, the other thing you can do is pair these with a warm amp. These do not like being on a clinical or dry amp. These on the A90, these on the RME's inbuilt amp, are just dry and pretty thin. The combination of the speed that they offer, but the lack of upper mid-range warmth does not go well with that kind of thing. I like these. I love the AHB2. That is my favorite amp. I like these the most on the Cavalli Tube Hybrid and the Asgard 3 from Shit. I like these best on a really warm amp. So let's pop these on the Asgard and play the same song again. There we go. Now we're getting to the point where I wouldn't actually really have much of an issue with it. I wouldn't say it's particularly problematic for vocals if you have the EQ running and you have them on a warm amp. You don't need a lot of power because, again, you can run these on nothing but willpower, but these on a warm amp, like the Asgard 3, really does turn them from being quite a dry headphone to being a very enjoyable headphone for most genres. I want to stress, though, if you like vocals, if you like acoustic music, if you like even kind of more poppy stuff like this, it might not be appropriate for you. I would definitely take an Aria over the LCDX if you listen to a lot of acoustic type music or stuff which is vocal heavy. But for EDM, for electronic, for dubstep, for synthesized music, these are really, really good fun. And so a lot of people want to know, should I get a Hi-Fi Man Aria or an LCDX? And I don't think that's necessarily a question of which headphone is better. I think these are two very different headphones. The Aria is unquestionably more comfortable. The LCDX is definitely a lot heavier. The Arias are a lot harder to drive. These actually need, you don't need a lot of power to get them loud, but you do need quite a bit of power in order to get them sounding good. The LCDX has faster low end. It's got faster and I would say better low end overall, although the Aria has the edge in timbre. Mid-range definitely goes to the Aria, even though these are a somewhat bright headphone. Treble, they're very different. These have much better soundstage, much better resolution, but they can come off a little bit too bright for some. I would say definitely get the Aria if you listen to pop music or vocals. Orchestral does really well on these. Get the LCDX if you listen to EDM, electronic, what some might describe as weeb music, that kind of thing. These are not a headphone that is going for realism. These are not a headphone that is going for a convincing sound. These are a headphone that is going for a fun, engaging, slap you around the back of the head type sound. These are going for realism. These are going for space. These are going for timbre. These are going for detail. These are not direct competitors. The only thing that's similar about them is the price. Other than that, they're very, very different. And I can totally see why someone would want to have both of these. But there's an asterisk to that as well. The person who sent me these is actually selling these now. And he said he's doing that because in the time that he's lent them to me, he said he's not missing them. They do some really good fun stuff. These do have fantastic low end, and for certain genres, certain tracks. In fact, let's just play another one. Let's do Sad Bot by Pixel. Let's try find that. This is great fun on these headphones, and for this track, I would definitely rather have an LCDX. But it still sounds great on the Aria. And there's only a few tracks where I go, yeah, I'd rather have an LCDX, but I'd be very happy with the Aria. But then there's a lot of tracks where I'd go, it doesn't sound good on the LCDX, and I need an Aria. So that's where the bit of the asterisk comes in, is that these will sit fine in a collection, but I would not have these as your only headphone unless you know you only listen to a couple specific genres, or if you have a collection of headphones and you have something else you can turn to when these aren't going to do the job properly. So let's wrap things up then. I love these for electronic music. I think these are fantastic, and if you only listen to weeb music or electronic music or EDM, these are fantastic, and you're going to love them. If you listen to pretty much anything else, especially stuff which relies on convincing sounding vocals, these aren't going to be your cup of tea. These are not going to work for you. These are really, really good fun for stuff which needs force and speed and doesn't need realism. But for things which need realism, these don't work. Definitely use the EQ. The EQ helps a lot. I will post the bands, if I can find my mouse, for this EQ in the description so that you can replicate it yourself without the use of the Audazy Reveal software. So if you're using USB Audio Player Pro on a phone or something, you can try them out. Definitely would recommend pairing these with a warm amp as well. These on an Asgard 3 or even a Cavalli Tube Hybrid. This is a kind of laid-back type amp, but because this is a really forward and fast-sounding headphone, it doesn't matter. It kind of evens out a bit. Asgard 3 was the best pairing, though, by far. Magnius, definitely not. A90, definitely not. AHB2 was definitely good, but I prefer the Asgard 3. I like these a lot. I don't think you should buy them unless you only listen to those specific genres. If you have any questions at all, if you want to ask on my Discord, if you want to ask in the comments, there are links to the description below, or you can leave a comment below. A huge thank you to all my patrons, especially my Diamond and Legend tier patrons, King Jung-un, Chris, Ross Kyle, Daniel Mellinger, and Lana Bennett. You guys are fantastic. If you'd like to support me on Patreon or Subscribestar, there are links in the description. You can join the private Telegram chat where we talk about audio stuff and videos and everything all day. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed. If you have any questions, do leave them in the comments and I'll do my best to answer. Join the Discord server and come and have a chat there. Until next time, have a great day.